Recorded Books Inspirational presents an unabridged recording of The Hidden Flame by Davis Bunn and Janette Oke, narrated by Susan Lyons. This book is copyrighted 2010 by Davis Bunn and Janette Oke. This recording is copyrighted 2010 by Recorded Books, producer and publisher of Recorded Books Inspirational, an imprint dedicated to stories of faith and the human spirit. And now, The Hidden Flame.
Chapter 1. Jerusalem, AD 33. Abigail quietly withdrew from the celebration and limped into the shadow's coolness. Her leg throbbing, she eased herself down onto a stone bench by the courtyard's outer wall. Around her hummed the gaiety of wedding revelers. Never had she witnessed such joyous festivities. She felt as though the tension, the anguish, the uncertainties of the past weeks had been transformed. The group was not merely celebrating the wedding of Alban and Leah. There was a far greater reason beyond the joyful union of these two new followers of the way. They all rejoiced in the truth they had believed, but that now had been confirmed. Their leader, the Rabbi Jesus, had indeed risen from the dead, and there were eyewitnesses to the fact. Abigail watched 12-year-old Jacob as he danced back and forth among the merrymakers with a fervor bordering on hysteria. Abigail was still marveling that her brother was alive, whole and well. The time since the massacre of her family had seemed an eternity, a lifetime of feeling lost and alone. And just hours ago, she had caught a glimpse of the boy across the courtyard, and it was as if he too had been resurrected. A miracle that seemed like a dream. The very thought brought tears to her eyes once again. Jacob must have felt her looking at him, for he turned as though seeking her. When their glances connected, he ran over to her, concern in his dark eyes. "Why aren't you dancing too, Abigail? Are you not well?" "I'm fine, Jacob." And she was. Her injured leg hurt rather a lot, but just then she could feel nothing save the joy in her heart. Her beloved friend Leah danced with her new husband Alban in the circle of believers, and her brother stood before her. Her brother! "I'm only a bit weary," she assured him. "Shall I bring you something?" He glanced at the wedding banquet table spread with flowers and greenery, all ready for the feast to come. Suddenly, she needed to touch him, just to assure herself he was not merely an apparition. She reached up to his shoulder with a tremulous smile. "Perhaps some water. Thank you." When Jacob dashed away, her attention returned to the jubilant crowd filling the little plaza. Could it be only 6 weeks past that our Lord died? The group of followers, already under suspicion, had locked themselves away, whispering solemn and frightened words to one another, checking anxiously about whenever they needed to enter the Jerusalem streets. And then Jesus had appeared to them, afterward rising up into the heavens, only to have the Lord's own spirit descend among them in a most stunning fashion, in wind and fire. And now here they were, faces flushed, eyes bright, voices blending into song. The music of tambourines and flutes swirled upward once more, setting feet to dancing, a wedding festival for sure, but also a celebration of their Lord's resurrection and his parting gift to them of his unseen but unmistakable presence. "And the return of Jacob," Abigail whispered to herself with a little smile as she fanned her face with a palm leaf. How good it was to have so many reasons to celebrate. If only my leg didn't hurt so. She reached discreetly beneath her robe to rub it. She would have loved to be among those dancing. She would whirl on and on around the courtyard. "Here you go, sister." Abigail couldn't help her little shiver of joy at the familial address coming from a lad she had thought lost to her forever. She smiled her thanks and took the earthenware mug, but was unable to drink because her throat was closed up tight with emotion. Jacob turned back to watch the clapping, singing throng. She nodded and motioned for him to go and join them. She could tell he was torn, but she gave his shoulder a little push. "Go, Jacob. Dance for both of us," she managed to say through tears of joy. He was gone in a flash, and she watched him join hands to weave in and out among their friends. Her dear friend Hannah was among them, a circlet of white flowers wreathing her head. Leah and her bridegroom had already slipped away to their bridal chamber. Abigail roused herself. She should be assisting Martha and Mary, who were now bringing platters of roast lamb to tables stretching along the opposite wall. Sounds of laughter caught her attention above the general hubbub. One of the fishermen from the Galilee must have been telling an amusing tale. Though she didn't hear the words, she couldn't help but smile again as the man slapped his companion good-naturedly on the back and they roared together. She sighed and attempted to rise as she saw the women carrying earthen bowls of plump red grapes and ripe olives. She had helped prepare the dipping sauce made from dried chickpeas, along with a dish containing fresh spring onions and coriander and mint. Inviting fragrances filled the cooling air. "Abigail," Martha called over to her, "come and take your place at the table." Though the voice was direct and curt, Abigail knew the heart. It was love that spoke. "I should be helping." "There are many more hands to do it. I saw you limping earlier. Now sit and eat." As Peter rose from his seat to bless the food, Abigail moved reluctantly to a place at the women's table. She loved to hear him pray aloud, words addressed to Jehovah, but ones of such comfort and insight. Scarcely had she settled into her seat, however, when someone plucked at her sleeve. Nedra, from Herod's household, was crouching down beside Abigail. This was astonishing, for despite Leah's entreaties, Nedra's superior, Enos, had refused to permit her to attend today's celebration. "Oh, Nedra, Leah will be so happy to hear that Enos relented." But Nedra was already shaking her head. Panting so hard, her breath puffed against Abigail's face, she leaned close to gasp out, "Enos doesn't know I've come. They must leave, at once." Abigail felt the words jostle in her head. "Who do you mean?" "Leah, Alban, they must go now." Nedra's eyes were wide, fearful. Laughter spilled over them from the table's opposite side. The woman's agitation didn't fit into the day. "But Leah and Alban, they're..."
"Now! You must hear me!"
Nedra's fingers tugged at Abigail's robe. "There is no time!"
"You don't understand, Nedra. They've gone to the bridal chamber." "Herod has already dispatched his guards!"
Nedra's eyes looked wild. A voice from Abigail's other side said, "Is something the matter?" She was relieved to find Martha standing behind her bench.
"Nedra tells me there is a danger, but I was trying to explain." "And I am telling you they must flee!"
Nedra was on her feet, her arms waving wildly. A young man named Stephen was suddenly beside them. Abigail could see the fine lines in his dark complexion as concern creased his forehead. Yet in spite of Nedra's obvious consternation, he exuded the most remarkable sense of calm. "Please, Nedra, is it? Please, tell us."
"If Enos realizes I am gone, he will have me killed."
Nedra wiped her brow with a shaking hand. "Then we can't allow that to happen. You must thirst if you've run all this way. Martha, bring her a drink, please. Now then, tell us what has happened." Abigail saw the woman's shudder.
"Herod is dispatching his guards," she repeated hoarsely.
"For Leah?"
"And Alban. Herod continues to seek vengeance on them both. They are to be brought in and given a hasty trial, and then he will put them both to death.
You are sure?
I overheard the plans.
Is there anyone we can appeal to? Martha arrived with the cup, but Nedra only held it.
No, she said. Pilate has left for Caesarea, which is why Herod is acting now.
Nedra's breath returned to its frantic spasms.
I must return. Every moment I stay is added danger.
Of course you must. Stephen lifted his gaze around the courtyard.
Jacob, he called. We need your help. Will you see this lady safely and quickly back to the palace?
The lad might have been young, but he responded immediately. He must have sensed the danger.
I know the secret passages. Come.
He beckoned as he turned toward the gate.
Good lad.
Stephen nodded and smiled at Nedra. You were right to come.
Tell them I am sorry, but they must hurry.
Nedra allowed Jacob to grip her hand and pull her away as her last words trailed over her shoulder.
Tell them to make haste. Give them my love and prayers.
Our own go with you. Now hurry.
Stephen turned to Martha. We must tell them. Abigail realized the music had stopped and the group was watching them.
Could we not hide them?
She asked, her voice sounding choked in her ears. Martha responded quickly. Nedra is not given to undue panic. She has risked her life to save her friends.
If Herod has already ordered his guards out, we must hurry, Stephen added. Not even the emergency could erase his innate calm. Alban and Leah are in grave danger. There is no place here for them to hide, not from Herod's ire, not in this city. Nedra is right. They must flee.
Abigail found strength she didn't know she had. She turned to Martha.
I will go to warn them. Would you collect some food in a sack for them?
Stephen was already moving away.
I will see if we can manage a horse.
As Abigail rushed frantically up the wooden steps to the chamber that she and Hannah called their own, the one they had decorated and offered to the bridal couple, she heard a woman's soft laughter. She had never heard Leah laugh before. And now, how quickly the moments of joy must end. Her eyes filled with tears as she stood at the room's door. She was about to call to them when the door opened. Alban stood with his arm about Leah's waist.
What is it, Abigail? I heard running footsteps.
Herod.
The word tasted foul on her lips.
His troops are coming for you. Now, there is no time.
She halted because Alban was now gripping her arm.
Steady, he said. Now tell me again.
Herod is sending his guards. Nedra slipped out from the palace to warn us. He intends...
She could go no further.
Leo whispered. What are you saying?
Pilate has left the city, Alban explained, his tone grim. Herod sees this as his chance to retaliate for thwarting his plans.
Abigail flung herself against Leah, the tears turning to sobs as she wrapped her arms around her friend.
You must flee, the troops.
Leah's arms felt warm as they tightened about Abigail's shoulders.
Grab your things, you and Jacob. We must hurry.
The guards are not after Abigail and Jacob, Leah.
The steel in Alban's voice helped steady both women.
It is far too dangerous for them to accompany us. We will move more swiftly, less noticeably, alone.
But,
Leah, if the guards are already hunting, we must go now. After we make it to safety, we will send for them.
Jacob has taken Nedra back to the palace.
Abigail wiped her face.
Alban is right. And my leg...
Leah gripped her more tightly still. Gently, Alban eased Leah away.
We must go.
We will send word as soon as we can, Leah said over her shoulder as she was hurried down the stairway. I promise.
Abigail sank down on a step, face in her hands and tears running through her fingers.
Oh God, give them speed,
Protection was all she was capable of praying. The only animal Stephen could locate on short notice was the donkey they used for transporting firewood from the valley. Abigail could see from Auburn's expression that this was not what he had hoped for. Fear of capture showed in the depths of his eyes. Thankfully, Leo was too busy embracing the women to notice. By the time she had climbed onto the donkey's back and looked once more in her beloved's direction, Auburn's features had resumed their grim strength.
We must leave.
Where will you go? Abigail asked.
It's best you do not know. If you have no knowledge, you cannot be put in a dangerous position.
Even stoic Martha was fearful.
That donkey will not get you far.
Auburn gripped the lead rope and started forward.
We have little choice.
As they reached the plaza's gate, the sound of hooves rang up the narrow passage. Abigail was close enough to see Auburn reach to his belt, but his fist gripped empty air. He turned to Leah and said, "Prepare to run."
"I will never leave you."
Auburn began to argue, then turned toward the horse and rider racing furiously up the little street. "Linux," he called, as he and Leah wheeled into place in front of him. The soldier's face was grim.
"Herod's men are fast on my heels." Linux slipped from his horse. "Take my mount and run like the wind."
The two officers embraced. Hesitancy quickly turned into a firmness that bespoke military colleagues who had become friends. Then Auburn flipped up onto the horse's back and pulled Leah up behind him. Stephen and Martha pushed quickly gathered bundles for the journey into their arms. For one brief instant, the pair stared around at the gathered throng, a silent moment too full for words. Then Auburn spun the horse about and dug in his heels. Abigail twisted a corner of her shawl and lifted it to wipe the tears running down her cheeks. Fear nearly compressed her chest, and she wondered when, if, she would ever see them again. She felt eyes observing her, and realized that the soldier, Linux, was not watching his friend depart. He was looking at her. A chill ran through Abigail. She had noticed the handsome Roman officer before, as well as his boldness. She tightened the shawl about her face, covering all but her eyes, and turned away to watch the fast-fleeing mount carrying Auburn and Leah disappear around the corner. As the sound of their racing gallop over the cobblestones faded away, Abigail moved her head to see the entire community of believers standing in stunned silence. No longer the wedding music, no longer the laughter and camaraderie, the dancing and feasting. Once more their world had abruptly changed, and they were reminded of who they were, where they were. Aliens in their own land. Judeans, certainly, yet viewed as enemies by both their own religious leaders as well as the Roman conquerors. Out of the silence came a confident voice. Though little more than a whisper, it resonated through the silent courtyard, a prayer that came from the heart and soul of the former fisherman of the Galilee.
"Go with God," breathed Peter.
"Go with God," echoed throughout the group, as though the entire gathering took a fresh breath. Yes. After all, God was with the two now escaping for their lives, as he was with those left to face the hunters. Abigail was still reeling from the dramatic events of the last moments when a panting Jacob tugged at her shawl. He could scarcely voice his question.
"Are they hidden?"
Abigail clutched his shoulders with both hands.
"Did Nedra?" "We made it," he puffed. "I don't think Enos knew she'd ever left."
"Thank God," breathed Abigail.
"Where's Auburn?"
"Gone. They..."
"Gone? What do you mean? Where?"
"They've left. We can only pray that their escape will be successful."
But how could he leave without me? I was to go. He promised he'd never leave me."
Abigail looked at her brother's stricken face and realized what he was trying to say.
He couldn't wait, Jacob. Auburn and Leah were in danger, you know that.
Even as she spoke, they heard the sound of horses' hooves, many of them, clattering upon the paving stones coming up to the courtyard. The hunters had arrived.
Quick, Abigail pushed at Jacob. We must hide before they enter. When he resisted, she pulled him forward. Run, Jacob!
He half turned to look at her.
Run where?
Behind the washtubs, out back. There's an alley that leads to the back streets. They hurried across the courtyard just as prancing mounts snorted and stomped their way into the enclosure. Abigail heard the crude shouts of soldiers, the clanging of steel blades. She pressed Jacob into the shadows behind her, afraid that any movement would get unwanted attention.
The man Auburn, where is he?
Came an angry shout from the obvious leader of the soldiers.
He is not here.
It was Peter's voice that met the demand.
We were informed he is in this compound. You deny this?
The voice was harsh.
I do not deny that he was here. It is his wedding day. We celebrated the claiming of his bride, and... I'm not interested in your celebrations. Where has he gone?
He did not say. The soldier released a volley of curses.
We'll see if you know how to tell the truth. Men, dismount. Search every corner of this foul place from top to bottom. If this uncouth man here is lying, he'll soon mount a cross, along with the rest of his followers.
Abigail pulled in a deep breath and pressed more firmly against Jacob. Amid the noise and confusion in the courtyard, they would not likely be noticed.
This way, she hissed over her shoulder.
As they ducked into a passageway toward the back of the compound, she prayed,
Please, Father God, help us all. Lord Jesus, direct our steps. Holy Spirit, be with us.
Jacob, who knew the warren of back streets and alleyways of Jerusalem like his own hand, soon took the lead in their headlong rush to safety. Later that evening, in the back of a shed attached to the shop of a fishmonger who belonged to the followers' community, Jacob again plied Abigail with questions.
Where were Auburn and Leah headed? What were their plans? How soon would they send for him?
Over and over, her answers were the same.
I do not know.
His patience quickly came to an end.
Then what are we to do?
Wait, responded Abigail.
Wait!
Jacob attempted to scoff, but was near tears.
It was not to be this way. I need Auburn now. I didn't even get to say farewell, to receive instructions of what I am to do. How can you say wait? For what? For whom? What if they don't make it? How will we know?
His words tumbled over each other, a litany of his frustration and grief.
If they do not make it, Herod will be boasting of it from here to Rome,
Abigail finally said, trying to rein in her impatience. Even if they do make it, he might claim they didn't, just to save face.
There is nothing that we can do, Jacob, but wait. They will send word when they can. They will send for us when the time is right.
But Jacob failed to be convinced. Abigail could feel him withdraw from her in the blackness of the night. It hurt deeply. Had she found Jacob merely hours ago, only to lose him in his sorrow over Auburn? She prayed not. But for the moment, her heart felt even colder than the night's chilly arms encircling them. Chapter 2. Caesarea, 25 months later. The sight that greeted Lyons as he stepped once more upon Judean soil was of children playing. Two youngsters raced along the top of the stone harbour wall. Lyons was instantly transported back to his brother's villa. The two girls Lyons had left behind in Umbria were both blonde,
and these scampering children were dark-haired, yet both pairs shared an impish laughter and an ability to find joy in chasing a butterfly or a dog through dust and sunlight. Linux had dreamed of his twin nieces almost every night since leaving Umbria, his country of birth, for Rome and from there to Judea. Another committed bachelor might have considered it a recurring nightmare, but after what Linux had discovered while in Rome, he felt the dreams contained his one tiny shred of hope.
Linux, you are indeed a sight for sore eyes.
The harbour master was a former ship's captain from Tyre. Horace liked to claim he had skippered a Phoenician pirate vessel, but Linux knew he had served Rome long and well, both on sea and land. Some years back, a ship's timber had pinned Horace to the deck during a storm. As he walked toward Linux with hand outstretched, the harbour master's gait rocked like a ship in heavy seas.
What news of Rome? The women are as lovely as ever,
Linux dredged up the sardonic grin the harbour master would have expected,
and much lonelier now that I have departed. And the husbands breathe much easier, I warrant.
Horace slapped Linux on the back and steered him toward the stone hut from which he supervised the comings and goings of all vessels in the harbour.
You and I will share a glass.
My belongings, Horace pointed to his assistant.
You see to them. Come, Linux, I must hear of all the wailing ladies.
But once inside the hut's shadows, the harbour master's humour vanished like the mist on the Mediterranean at dawn.
Wine?
Tea. I have much to do before sundown.
I can imagine.
Horace stuck his head out the cabin's door and bellowed,
Where is that scurvy dog?
Here, master.
Tea, good food.
Just tea, Linux corrected. The harbour master looked at him askance.
You've been at sea for weeks, my man.
Almost 2 months, Linux agreed. 2 weeks since our last landfall. We received fresh bread from the baker not 2 hours ago.
Just tea, with my thanks. Linux ignored his growling belly. Horace gave his servant the order and slouched into his chair. Linux noted the table beneath the window piled high with charts and scrolls. The man's badge of office, the Emperor's seal, held down an unfurled manifest, no doubt awaiting his calculation of the duties to be paid. Horace asked again, more subdued this time.
What news of Rome? Are you sure you want to hear, old friend? Everyone in Caesarea is feasting on rumours, all of them dreadful. The truth can hardly be worse.
I would not wager on that.
So it is true. Sejanus is in trouble.
Linux sighed and stared out the window. Since Emperor Tiberius had retired to his palace on the island of Capri, Rome had been ruled by his deputy, Sejanus, whose only official title was head of the Praetorian Guard. Tiberius remained officially the ruler of the empire, but the emperor was increasingly interested only in his own pleasures. What was most troubling to Linux was that many of Rome's powerful and wealthy citizens were following Tiberius's example, letting whatever gratification caught their fancy sweep them away into increasing debauchery. Sejanus battles constantly with the Senate, Linux finally said. And he is losing. The harbour master scowled.
This does not bode well for the likes of you and me.
The servant appeared in the doorway. Tea, master. Linux accepted his mug with a nod of thanks and said,
Let us walk.
The sun is blistering, Horace protested.
To remain hidden away is a danger for us both, he murmured. Horace followed him out into the afternoon light.
You are so fearful of spies?
I do not yet know for certain what we face, Linux said, his voice still low. I can only tell you what I found upon my arrival in Rome.
Then tell me.
Horace was an old friend and one of Linux's most trusted allies in Caesarea.
Lynx also knew that whatever he told Horus would make its cautionary way through the garrison's ranks. News travelled fast in a provincial capital, and the information thus carried provided the only hope of survival. 14 months earlier, Lynx had returned home to northern Italy. His brother's first wife had died, and Castor was remarrying. Lynx had received an official summons, his older brother using the opportunity to test Lynx's loyalty. Lynx's visit home had not gone well, he freely admitted to the harbour master. The only part of that experience Lynx failed to share was how he spent much of the time playing with his nieces, his brother's daughters from the first marriage. The little ones missed their mother terribly, and now with their father giving his attentions to his new young bride, the girls felt totally adrift. While in Umbria, Lynx heard of events further south in the capital. The old emperor, Tiberius, seemed incapable of focusing on anything other than his pleasure gardens on Capri. His deputy Sejanus repeatedly came into conflict with the Roman Senate. In defiance of Sejanus and Tiberius, the Senate ordered Pontius Pilate's return from Judea in disgrace. In his stead, the Senate had appointed a trusted ally as replacement consul to Judea, a man named Marcellus. Fortunately, Lynx had not been caught up in the unfolding political turmoil, nor had he been included when the orders arrived commanding Pilate to present himself before the Senate. Since Pilate could be banished or even executed along with his entire cadre of senior officers, Lynx's exclusion from the whole sorry scenario was a very good thing indeed. But what Lynx had found awaiting him in Rome so disturbed him that even now, nearly 500 leagues away, his gut still clenched in the telling. Horace stared silently out over the crowded Caesarea port, though Lynx doubted his old friend actually saw very much at all. Finally, the man muttered, "How is a simple officer of the sea to survive all this?" Lynx repeated what an ally in Rome had told him. "Be extremely careful in everything you say, everything you do, maybe even everything you think." "When does the new prelate arrive?" Horace leaned on the stone wall circling the harbour. "He was to leave the week following my departure. I was ordered ahead to..." Lynx waved that aside. It would not be appropriate to further discuss imperial business with the harbour master. He said instead, "We were struck by 2 storms. There is no telling when his vessel will dock, or at which port." The 2 youngsters chose that moment to come racing up. The stone wall placed the boys' smiling faces at eye level with the 2 men.
"Uncle, come play with us."
"Can't you see I'm busy here?"
But Horace's growl contained a genuine fondness. When the 2 ran away laughing, Horace muttered, "Young scamps," though his pride was apparent.
"You're their uncle?" "In a manner of speaking. Their father was a mate of mine. His ship went out 3 winters back and never returned. I've been adopted by them, as have half the men who work under me. They're delightful one moment and rascals the next."
Lynx leaned forward so as to watch as they raced to where an old sailor repaired a fishing net. The shorter of the 2 boys took up one of the arrow-shaped shuttles. The ancient mariner fitted his large hand around the smaller one and helped him weave the rough twine as the other child watched silently. On some unseen cue, the 2 boys started singing about fishing on a summer's dawn and the ladies who waited back home, clearly a song taught to them by seafaring men around the harbour. The sailor leaned back and laughed out loud, the sound rusty with disuse. Lynx suddenly asked, "Have you ever thought of marrying, Horace?" Horace turned from the wall toward the stone hut.
"Women and the sea are like oil and water. They do not mix."
Lynx fell into step beside him.
"I've heard the same of soldiers and wives." Horace's eyes grew wide in obvious alarm. "Don't tell me your heart has been stolen by a lass back in Rome."
"In Umbria,"
Lynx confessed. Two of them. My brother's daughters. They laugh like those two there. Can they cause the same mountain of mischief when they have a mind? No doubt. Lynx looked back at the boys, his heart twisted by the memory of his last day with his brother's twins. He had entered their room to find the girls arguing over a tiny carved wooden doll. He had gently teased them into reconciliation, bringing laughter to their eyes. It didn't last long. They had wept inconsolably when Lynx had told them he was leaving for Rome. Lynx kicked at a small stone with his scuffed sandal, shrugging to hide his deep emotion, and dared to murmur to the sun and the hot summer wind, "I do miss them." 2 days later, Lynx left Caesarea for Jerusalem in the company of a mounted troop. He had not planned to travel so, but orders had been issued from Bruno Aetius, tribune of the Jerusalem garrison. Without a governor in place, the tribune commanded all Roman troops in Judea, and Bruno Aetius's order was that all Roman soldiers taking to Judea's roads must travel in strength. So Lynx attached himself to a troop assigned guard detail and set forth. He was not sorry to see the back of Caesarea, which was very odd, for it was the only truly Roman city in the entire province, and Lynx held no love for Jerusalem, none whatever. But perhaps at the moment, Jerusalem was preferable. Caesarea, the Roman capital of Judea, was at present a boiling pot. Rumors swirled and the people fretted. And the news from Rome... Lynx shook his head. Their first night on the road, they camped in the very same ruined village where Lynx, 2 years past, had escaped a late-season rain in the company of a stranger who became a friend. Around the fire that night, Lynx asked the troop's commander, "Did you know the centurion, Auburn?" "Knew of him." The officer was a hard-bitten man of middle years named Cyrus, suggesting someone from a far-flung province still holding to the Greek ways. "He was a friend of yours?" "Perhaps the best it has ever been my good fortune to know." Cyrus took no ease by the fire. He didn't sit in the camp chair so much as crouch at its edge. His eyes constantly surveyed the perimeter, out where light from the soldiers' three fires was swallowed by the night. "Is it true what they say? The centurion went native." "He married a Judean. He gave up his commission. That much is true." "I meant no offense, sir." "None taken. And on the road, I am Lynx." He studied the officer across the fire from him. Lynx would have expected a more relaxed demeanor at a campfire after a decent enough meal, especially with a double guard posted. "Do you expect trouble?" "On these roads, always. Much has changed while you've been away." "I thought it bad enough before I left." "Bad then? Now worse." Lynx nodded. "I'm not talking about changes at the top," Cyrus said. "Governors come, they rule for a time, and they go. My concern remains with the men under my command." My friend Auburn might have voiced the very same words. When the other officer continued to study the night, Lynx went on. Pilate had planned to banish the centurion for failing him in a duty. Though in truth, Auburn failed no one. He merely reported news that Pilate didn't wish to hear. But before he was to depart for his new posting, Auburn... Lynx stopped when Cyrus leapt to his feet. Lynx rose and gripped his sword, listening intently, but he heard nothing. The night was utterly still, without a breath of wind. Their fire crackled, sending cinders flying up to join the stars overhead. "What is it?" "Perhaps nothing." Cyrus replaced the sword Lynx had not even seen him draw and gradually lowered himself to his seat. "What was the news your friend brought back to the prelate?" "That the Judean prophet known as Jesus of Nazareth, the one who was crucified, was alive."
The officer focused fully upon Lynx. I have heard this rumor. His followers are growing like a wildfire.
Alban is one of them. A high-pitched shriek pierced the darkness, and a soldier just on the edge of the nearest campfire collapsed into the dust. Cyrus leapt forward, hollering, "To arms!" The night was suddenly filled with a whirring sound. Lynx rolled and came up beneath his shield as arrows rained down upon the campground. Two hammered into the wood of his shield. Lynx crouched more tightly, drawing his head down to where it almost rested on his knees. Around him, he saw that even the legionnaires who had been fast asleep now hunkered behind their shields. Clearly, these men had been attacked before. Once again, arrows hammered against his shield, one thumping down within inches of his shin. Another soldier shouted in pain. Cyrus shouted, "They're hidden in the rocks to the west! Attack!" Lynx roared with the others. He unsheathed his sword and raced for the rocks. He leapt upon the stone to the left of Cyrus, but all they found was empty sand turned silver in the starlight.
"Squads of three, spread out! Search every defile!"
But Cyrus sheathed his sword and motioned for Lynx to follow him back into the camp. As Lynx helped him tend to the pair of wounded men, he asked, "Should I search with your scouts?" "My men won't find anything, but I gave the order to be safe. These attacks never vary. They come with the night. They strike in stealth, they slip away and vanish." Cyrus patted one of the soldiers. "These are just flesh wounds. We'll bathe and bind them. You'll both ride tomorrow. The surgeons will leave you with some scars for the ladies to admire."
Cyrus lifted his head and called his men back. They returned, facing outward, a tactic so ingrained their officer needed to give them no instructions. Lynx knew none would sleep again that night.
"Who were the marauders?" Lynx wondered. "We know nothing for certain."
"What? You haven't captured any?"
"Not in 8 months of such attacks."
Lynx recalled the troubles with bandits he and Alban had faced.
"Parthians? Not this far west. Though we hear they've grown bolder on the Damascus Road. No, this is trouble that has grown up here in Judea."
"Do they have a name?"
Cyrus swept the night with his gaze.
"They call themselves Zealots."
Chapter 3. Ezra always felt a vague sense of envy when visiting Gamaliel in Jerusalem's temple quarter. A broad avenue ran from the temple to the citadel, from one center of Judean power to the other. Most priests who served on the Sanhedrin, the temple council, lived along this road. But it was not Gamaliel's position among the temple priesthood and the larger Judean community that sparked Ezra's jealousy. It was something else.
"Welcome, old friend. Welcome."
Gamaliel, elder Pharisee and longtime mentor to Ezra, received his childhood friend in the main room overlooking the courtyard. A central fountain cast rainbows that were being scattered by the afternoon wind.
"How is Alexandria?"
Gamaliel waved Ezra towards chairs adjoining a small carved table. Ezra sighed and nodded as he seated himself.
"Filled with chaos and confusion, like the rest of the empire."
He was a senior merchant whose trading empire had stretched out from Jerusalem as far as Damascus on the east and Rome to the west. He nodded his thanks as a servant washed his hands and feet in the traditional manner. He accepted a silver goblet and tasted the fruit-flavored water. The priest certainly lived well, Ezra noted, as he gazed around the large room.
"What is new in Jerusalem?"
"So much has happened."
Gamaliel's voice faded at the sound of footsteps hurrying down the side passage. Both men turned toward the arched opening.
"Ezra!" The woman moved quickly across the room, almost tripping in her haste and joy. "How dare you stay away so long?"
There were difficulties, Miriam. I do apologize. Your son and daughter are well?
She sat down on a wooden bench situated near the chairs.
They seem to thrive upon the journey, unlike their weary father.
They are young. They are free of tutors and boundaries, off on an adventure with their beloved father. How could they not enjoy such a trip?
Our own son wailed inconsolably when he learned you had taken the children. Next time he may come as well.
She waved her finger.
If you even dare mention such a thing, I will give you...
Shove, Miriam, her husband chided, though he smiled. Shame.
Ezra listened to the woman discuss her and Gamaliel's children, then join in with her husband to describe the changes in Jerusalem, the dismissal of Pilate, and the awaited arrival of the new governor, Marcellus. Then there were the rumors that the tribune of the Judean garrison, Bruno Aetius, was to be sent back to Damascus. Some of the news Ezra had heard in Alexandria. Other items were new. He tried hard to pay attention, for these were two well-connected, intelligent, and trusted friends. But his envy formed a cloud of pain and remorse in his mind and heart, such that it was difficult to follow the conversation at all. Miriam and Ezra's late wife had been best friends. Miriam and Gamaliel's two children were almost the exact same age as his own, 4 and 6. Yet their home was complete and full of the constancy of love, while his own had been torn to shreds. 2 years earlier, his beloved young wife had slipped on a wet tile floor and fallen. It had seemed like nothing. A bruise on her elbow, another above her temple. A bit of pain, but not so much as to cause alarm. That night, however, she'd said she had a headache, felt a bit dizzy. By morning, she was gone. Ezra's inner agony had lessened over time. He had found some healing for the deep sorrow as he turned to the needs of his two small children. But his heart still ached for all that he had lost, and he felt it nowhere as keenly as here, in the peaceful home of his oldest friend. The children were brought in, their excited questions answered, and his heart felt the loss more keenly still. Finally, Miriam left with them and the maids, and Gamaliel ordered the other servants to leave and shut the doors. The room was enclosed in shadows as thick as the priest's sudden scowl. There is trouble.
The zealots? Ezra asked.
No. Well, yes, them too.
I have heard their attacks have grown impossibly daring. The attacks, yes, they are a scourge, but what is worse is their popularity among the common folk. I heard songs about them around the caravanserai campfires, Ezra recalled. One was very appealing, in a simple fashion. Something about a new Judean David fighting the Roman Goliath. My son has taken to singing it as he plays.
The people are oppressed, and they seek heroes, Gamaliel said. It's a natural enough reaction.
This was one of the man's most remarkable traits. Ezra knew that most men, as they rose to positions of genuine power, became increasingly rigid in their opinions. Their ability to question themselves or see another's point of view became lost. Gamaliel, however, was a mediator. He calmed the waters by truly seeking to understand what motivated another. It was a gift, this skill of listening and studying and respecting someone else's perspective. Ezra, however, held no such illusions.
They are a threat to us and our position within the community. The zealots will destroy everything we hold dear. The Romans will win in the end, and they will crush us along with the zealots.
Are you suggesting we help the Romans? Gamaliel's voice was low, but his meaning clear.
I am tempted, but I, for one, cannot condone that step.
Quite. Judeans aiding Romans to kill Judeans. It is an appalling prospect.
The Sanhedrin have done it before. Ezra's eyebrows arched pointedly. Gamaliel was silent. I'm speaking of the crucified prophet, the one they called Jesus of Nazareth. I know of whom you speak. Gamaliel rose and crossed to the window. They have adopted a new name.
Who?
The dead prophet's disciples. They call themselves followers of the way. The window's heavy drapes cast his friend's features in soft desert pastels, but Ezra could see he was very worried indeed. What difference does it make to us, the name a handful of Galilean rabble take for themselves? They are no longer a handful, and they're not just from Galilee. Some put their numbers at 3,000, others at 5, or more.
Impossible!
Ezra rose to his feet. Perhaps, but I trust my source. He named a senior priest at the Freedmen's Synagogue, a gathering place for many freed slaves, especially Judeans from outlying regions of the empire where Greek was still the predominant language. He says they're spreading like wildfire, most especially among the Jerusalem poor.
Just like the Essenes, Ezra murmured, sitting once again.
Yes and no.
The Essene movement has certainly gathered momentum over the past 10 years. It is said there are somewhere around 50 communities spread throughout Judea. Some number a few dozen members, others as many as 1,000. One of the largest lies east of the Mount of Olives, another on the Dead Sea's western shore. Some are celibate and restricted to men, others populated by entire clans. They are united in their loathing of the Sanhedrin and the temple priesthood, which they consider corrupt. But they've been a peaceful lot, electing to remove themselves entirely from the general population, waiting for the Messiah to come and rescue their nation. But in the current political and religious upheaval...
I don't understand, Ezra cut in.
You think even the Essenes might now preach violence?
No,
at least not yet.
They claim many astonishing things, Gamaliel replied, still facing the window. But violence is not among them.
Have these new disciples of the dead prophet joined with the zealots?
No, they too speak of peace. The priest gave a shudder. If they changed, what an appalling thought. I still don't.
No, nor I. Gamaliel strolled back over to his chair. All I can tell you for certain is that these followers of Jesus are growing faster than any sect we have ever faced, and the stories I hear grow with them. They still claim the prophet Jesus rose from the dead, walked among them, and then went up into the heavens. They claim he is the true Messiah. They claim...
Yes?
Miracles. Gamaliel said. Signs and wonders, things which inflame the passions of everyone within reach. Either the listeners join or they become enemies. Talk of them is everywhere. If anything sways them, diverts them, I fear a storm of such force that everything might soon be swept up and away. Ezra shifted uncomfortably in his seat.
Were this anyone else speaking, I would cast it aside as nonsense.
But it is I who talk with you, old friend, and this is not nonsense. How long were you gone? 4 months?
Almost 5.
So in 5 months, the followers have grown into a force that must be reckoned with. I would think the Sanhedrin would be very disturbed by all this. What does it propose to do? The Sanhedrin members are pulling their beards, looking down at the floor. They thought with the prophet dead, the rabble would soon disperse. They're only beginning to accept that this is something new. And many more are coming to believe that this dead prophet is in fact the long-awaited Messiah. It is growing into a powerful force within the community, one that must be confronted. Ezra caught the new tone. You have an idea, do you not?
Think of it. They have no allies in the power structure. I want you to go speak with their leaders. Ezra couldn't believe what he was hearing.
You cannot be serious. I'm just a merchant.
Precisely. They have nothing to fear from you. Gamaliel picked up a parchment from the table. Here are the names of their leaders we have managed to identify. Apostles, they are called. The street names are where local followers have opened their homes to the group. Some have given land which has now been set aside for their encampments outside the city gates. Go and meet with them. They are clearly poor. Build for us an ally. Offer them temple gold if need be. See if they can be trusted. Find out their intentions. And report back to me, old friend, and no one else. Ezra was a man of many talents. Son of a merchant from Tyre, he had travelled to Jerusalem at age 12 to study with a Pharisee scholar. Some said this man had been the finest living teacher of Torah anywhere in the world. At the time of Ezra's arrival, Gamaliel had been studying with the same teacher for almost 2 years. Gamaliel took young Ezra under his wing and helped him adjust to the alien worlds of the temple, the city of Jerusalem, and applied study. Ezra soon became aware that the Jerusalem scholars were already speaking of Gamaliel in awe, for the young man's mind absorbed verses and commentaries like a sea sponge. Gamaliel could either read or hear a text one time, then recite it back perfectly. They were already calling him a tzaddik, a man apart, one set aside by God for special purposes. Ezra had never possessed a scholar's mind such as Gamaliel's, nor did he much care. The eldest son, he had come for this time of study because it was a family tradition. His father had done so, as had his father's father, and on back through the 7 generations since the Maccabees had redeemed the temple and the scholars had returned to Jerusalem. Before sending Ezra south, his father had set 2 tasks before him. Of course, he was to study the Talmud and obey his teacher and bring honor to the family name. But there was something more besides. Ezra was also to establish allies within the temple hierarchy and the city of Jerusalem. His father assured him that such friendships, forged early and strong, would bear great fruit, even beyond financial ones, in the years to come. Ezra had eventually expanded the family empire. He had sent his younger brothers to establish new centers in Cyprus and Tarsus and Damascus. His sisters had wed, and through these marriages, Ezra had forged further powerful alliances. He had recently renewed contact with far-flung relatives, extending the family's trading reach as far as Spanish Gaul to the west and now to Alexandria to the south. His father had been correct, of course. The friendship with Gamaliel had borne great fruit. Ezra, for some years, had been the priest's largest benefactor. As Gamaliel had risen through the ranks to finally become one of the Sanhedrin, Ezra's power had risen with his. But there was more. Ezra possessed far-flung alliances forged in secrecy and maintained through utmost discretion. These were perilous times. The Roman Empire was in foment, especially here in the East. The Zealots were growing in power, their reach extending much farther and faster than even Gamaliel realized, for the priest had not left Jerusalem for years. In the provinces, talk of the Zealots was everywhere. More and more young men, infuriated by the foot of Rome upon their necks, were dropping their shepherd's crooks and their tools and leather aprons to slip away from farms and shops and forges, taking up the swords and the cause of the Zealots. Their families said Kaddish for them, the prayer of the dead, because it was an accepted fact that they would never hear from their loved ones again. Once a man entered the Zealots, his only possibility for opting out was through death, in battle, or by a zealot's sword as a traitor. Several young servants and workers of Ezra had already followed the call of adventure and glory and duty. Early on, he had realized that trying to stop them was futile. So he had let it be known that he wished contact with the leaders, not to negotiate, simply to offer assistance.
he became one of the first merchants to grant the zealots a tribute. As a result, his caravans were never touched, and he was often the first to receive news of any development. As with his other astute business decisions, he profited greatly. Now with this new group, these followers of the dead prophet Jesus, Ezra's plans were simple. If they were growing as fast as Gamaliel suggested, he needed to forge another alliance. Yes, of course he would assist Gamaliel with news and such, but what harm was there in some gain for himself? He was, after all, the son and grandson and great-grandson of successful merchants. So he tucked away the names that Gamaliel had offered him, and did as he had done so often in the past. He let it be known, through his employees and his allies, that he sought an audience with the leaders of this group. He assured them that he was curious, nothing more. He sought to gain, to learn, to give assistance. He came in peace. What was the harm in that?
Chapter 4. The day was already too hot, even though the glow from the sun was barely visible above its eastern bed. Abigail brushed at the persistent fly disturbing her sleep, hoping to sink back into the blissful comfort of slumber. She fanned the air above her, both to get some movement into the stillness and to scare away the pest. Her simple motion served to pull her further into the morning and into the responsibilities and challenges facing her. She stirred. What would this day hold? Simply another round of toil? Further revelations about their messiah to one or another of the group leaders? Longed-for news from Alban and Leah? Threats from those who didn't accept the truth? Or maybe even messiah's return? Abigail rolled from her pallet, now totally awake. After Leah and Alban's harrowing escape over 2 years previous, she and Jacob had returned from their overnight hideout to her quarters among the followers. Later, they had moved to the small lean-to at the back of the fishmonger's shop, and Jacob had settled into his Hebrew studies with varying degrees of cooperation, depending on the opportunities for adventure that day, while she continued her duties among the women. She heard no movement from the tiny loft above the room they called home. Jacob was either still asleep or had already left without her. They met each morning with a group of the followers for a time of thanksgiving and supplication, a practice maintained by members of their group throughout Jerusalem. Abigail rolled up her pallet and pushed it to the side of the small room. "Jacob, I fear we are late. Didn't the rooster crow?" she called. She had always depended on their neighbor's fowl to rouse her from her bed. "Jacob!" The muffled reply, drifting down from above, brought an unconscious sigh. Jacob had truly accepted neither the reality nor the reasons for Alban's sudden departure without him. Though Jacob didn't speak of it, she could feel his sorrow, his discontent. She knew Alban's leaving had left an enormous hole in her brother's life. She also knew he didn't enjoy his work assignment among the carpenters since his bar mitzvah. She had observed him sitting at the end of the day, saying nothing, just staring at his roughened and blistered hands. Abigail was sure she could read his expression. "These are not made to be handling rough wood, gathering splinters, forming calluses. No, they were made to clutch a sword, to signal an order to those under my command. If only Alban..." Some days Abigail felt she was losing her brother, one day at a time. He was becoming more silent, more withdrawn, and there seemed to be nothing she could do or say to bring him back. As many times before, she whispered a prayer as she prepared herself for the day. "Dear Father, may this be the day we hear from Alban, and keep Jacob..." She heard shuffling steps as Jacob slowly descended the ladder from the small loft over her head. His hair was tousled, his jaw set in a grim line. He said nothing, not even a morning greeting.
Did you sleep well? She asked cheerily. He merely nodded.
We must hurry. I overslept. I didn't hear the rooster.
Maybe we've been blessed and it died.
Abigail cast a quick glance his way. His expression hadn't changed. They soon left together, Jacob lingering a step behind. Already the streets were crowded, though the merchants and stall owners were not yet displaying their wares for barter or sale. In the half-light, no Roman soldiers paraded prancing horses over the cobblestones. A slight wind shook the leaves of the palm branches overhead, offering a breath of refreshing air that Abigail knew would soon become stifling with the day's heat. I wonder who will lead prayers this morning, she mused aloud, hoping to engage her brother. I believe Peter and John are both away.
Where are they this time? Grumbled Jacob.
Abigail turned toward him, new sorrow and regret filling her heart. A desire to protect this beloved brother welled within her. He was still young in her estimation, not yet 15, and already doing a man's work, though this certainly fit with their traditions. Day in and day out, he carried and sawed and shaped and planed heavy pieces of olive or cedar or pine. From dawn till dusk, he toiled at work that brought him no personal reward. Abigail knew there were men who loved the feel of the wood as they ran their calloused hands over the intricate grain. They understood just what it was as God had formed it, envisioned what it could become under skillful shaping and building, and also what it had been in the carpenter's hands. Not Jacob. To him, it was merely a task, tedious and unrelenting. She replied, "Visiting some of the brethren, I've heard." He merely shrugged. The walk to their meeting place was enough to cause her leg to throb with pain once more. She tried not to limp as Jacob's stride brought him abreast and then steps ahead of her. Her accidental burn from the scalding washwater had healed over, but the skin across the wound remained tight and sensitive to any stress or bump or bruise, and her days were often filled with such incidents, as she hoisted heavy clay jars or worked with other women in the close quarters of the kitchen. She often moved or stretched in a way that bumped against objects, causing a bruise or small tear in the scar. Normally she said nothing, simply waiting for the new injury to heal itself. She'd never been one for complaining. In fact, she would much rather sing, even on the worst days. But there were times when she couldn't hide her limp or conceal the discomfort that no doubt showed on her face. Jacob looked back at her, then slowed his pace. The simple act brought tears to Abigail's eyes. In spite of his moodiness, he still sought to assist her, to protect her. He always seemed to sense when her injury was causing her pain. They caught up to fellow worshippers heading to the courtyard. With brief greetings, they joined step, their voices hushed as they moved forward. It wouldn't do to draw attention to the growing numbers that gathered each day. A familiar shiver of excitement ran through Abigail. Will this be the day? When first the Lord had departed with the promise of his return, they had begun every day with that question on their hearts and lips. Later, they greeted one another with the unspoken question in their eyes. Gradually, they steeled themselves to accept that the Messiah might have other plans, or there might be some unknown reason why he was delayed. Certainly their numbers were expanding daily. They had been charged with spreading the word, to bring in others, to be his witnesses there in Jerusalem, in Samaria, and throughout the world. Was that not sufficient reason for him to prolong his coming? Gradually the group endeavored to put aside their yearning for his swift return, and to reach out to those who still needed the truth of his first arrival among them. But Abigail, in spite of her longing to be a good follower, often found herself hoping that this would be the day. Doubts and fears and threats and pain could all be left behind when their Messiah was once again among them in person. She had felt his healing touch once already, lifting the deep sorrow in her mind and heart. And maybe this time her leg, She glanced again at Jacob. She was sure that when the Lord returned, Jacob's unhappiness would once again be turned into the joyful exuberance she loved. She would gladly suffer the rest of her life if that could be so. Abigail was busy scrubbing cooking pots with sand and rinsing them for the next meal when Martha hurried into the kitchen, back straight, lips firmly pressed together. Abigail sensed immediately that all was not right, but held her tongue. The older woman stopped, took a deep breath, and brushed her arm over her forehead, sweeping back a few strands of delinquent hair. She looked flushed and weary with the day's work and the afternoon heat. Body and soul weary, Abigail thought, but she didn't speak. She straightened from her task and reached for a towel. Her eyes sought Martha's for an answer. It didn't come quickly. It was as though Martha was carefully sorting through her words. If only I were a younger woman, she murmured at last. Why don't you sit? Abigail invited. I still have fresh water here from the well. Martha sat down, her back remaining straight, chin lifted in a stubborn set. Abigail went to dip a cup of the cool water. Martha accepted it without comment and drank long and deeply. She passed back the empty cup, seeming somewhat restored. Abigail quietly took a place on the bench beside the woman. Martha would talk when she was ready. But after several moments, Martha still hadn't said a word. Abigail decided she had waited long enough. You would wish to be a younger woman, you said? Why is that? Martha shook her head and lifted her shawl to wipe her face. Could it be a young man has caught your fancy? Abigail added with a smile. Even the stoic Martha, after a shocked glance at Abigail, could not suppress a laugh. A man, she mused, dabbing again at her warm brow and damp hair. And a young one, you say? Now whatever would I want with one of those? Abigail shrugged. You would need to explain it to me. Such foolishness, Martha said with a shake of her head, but there was no edge to her tone, and her chin had lowered. She fanned at her face with the edge of her shawl.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.